hands right here. Come on.
All right. Glory to God.
Well, if you weren't here last week, Happy New Year. And, you know, the new year is always an exciting time because it's full of promise. And if you would open your Bibles with me to 1 Timothy chapter 6, and we're going to cover some familiar territory. 1 Timothy chapter 6, and we're going to look at verse 12. And I'm so thankful that God's Word is easy to be applied to everyday life. And the Scripture is our guidebook for life, if you will. I can't understand people who are of the opinion that you can't know God, or you can't understand God, or God is somehow mysterious. How can you say that when God has given us a record, a written record, of over 6,000 years of His interactions with mankind? And He's given us a record of how man missed it and how He brought redemption. And then, of course, we have the New Testament that gives us a personal account of the life, ministry of Jesus, His death, His burial, His resurrection, and then the ongoing ministry of the Holy Spirit. And the men who wrote these pages, inspired by the Holy Spirit, for the most part, were men who gave their lives for the effort and did so at great personal risk. And so now we're going to read something that Paul the Apostle wrote to Timothy. And Timothy at the time is a younger man, obviously, than Paul was. And he's pastoring the largest Christian church in the world at Ephesus. And he's facing persecution. His members are facing tests and trials. And you have to understand, we have a different viewpoint and perspective because we live in what I believe to be the greatest nation on the earth, the United States of America. It's not perfect, but it's a whole lot better than any place else. Amen. Amen. Pastor Martin has said to me a couple times, he said, you know, in my travels overseas, in particular when I go to Liberia or Ghana or Nigeria, he said, I always notice there are long lines to get into this country. He said, I've never seen a long line to get out. And so it's not perfect, but thank God we have an opportunity to worship and to, if need be, straighten things out. And so it was a different time when Paul wrote this letter to Timothy. They were living in a pagan world, and in many instances, if you declared faith in Jesus Christ, in many circles, it was offensive to them because that means you don't worship our little g God anymore. And so faith in Jesus Christ cost people their homes, their jobs, their livelihoods. And so they were in a real battle. And at the time Timothy was pastoring the church at Ephesus, it was a real struggle. But yet they prevailed. Now, fight the good fight of faith. Listen, there is a fight that each one of us is called to engage in. And this is the only fight the Christian is called to, the fight of faith. Now, you might on your own pick up other battles and fights that you want to get involved in, but this is the only one that God has told you to engage in. That does not mean if you serve in the military that you don't fight. No, there are Christian people who've fallen on either side of the issue. Amen? Well, the Bible says, thou shalt not kill. More literally, it says, you shall not commit murder. And, and I appreciate people who fall on either side. The founder of the Church of God in Christ, Bishop Mason, years ago adopted a doctrine that they believed it was not right for Christian men to take up arms. Now, that's what they believe. I don't believe it that way, but that's what he believed. And so the government in the state that he was living in didn't like that. And so they decided they would bring him up on charges. And they put him in the county jail. Read after the story. Do a little research. This is amazing. They put him in the county jail. And that night, with not a cloud in the sky, clear skies, lightning hit the courthouse. And it stunned them to the degree they released Bishop Mason the next day. So, well, Bishop, we apologize for that. You know, lightning struck the courthouse. You know, and I guess the jail was down, you know, downstairs. But lightning struck the courthouse on a clear sky with no clouds, no storm, no rain. And they thought, maybe we ought to let this man go. And they did. But there is a fight to fight, and it's the fight of faith. Now, listen, nobody in their right mind fights with themselves. So in order to fight the good fight of faith, faith must have some enemies. And we need to know and be able to identify who those enemies are so that we can fight properly. Now, this is important because we all know that faith is more than just what we talk about on Sunday morning. The Bible says over and over again, the just shall live by faith. And the word live is a Greek word that means to walk about, literally to live. Now, if you're like me, whenever somebody repeats something to you, you understand that it must be important. In the secular realm, I had a fella I worked for years ago who said to me, he said, "You know what I like about you?" I said, "No, what's that?" He said, "I only have to ask you once to do something." And I thought, well, you own the place. You shouldn't have to ask me twice. But he never had to ask me twice. If he asked me to do something, I did it. You know, it's either that or go someplace else. You know what I mean? So every time this man asked me to do something, and it wasn't often, I did it. And he said, "I like that." Well, a lot of people who worked for him, he had to ask him again and again and again. My mother, whenever she asked me to do something, or let me correct that, told me to do something, you better hop to it. If she had to tell you the second time, you're on dangerous ground. And if she had to tell you a third time and she starts using your name properly, "Listen here, David." Okay, I got it. I understand. You don't want mama to tell you to do something a third time. But it's wonderful that the scripture gives us such insight. In the Old Testament, the prophet Habakkuk said in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, "For the just shall live by faith." Then in the New Testament, the book of Romans chapter 1, verse 16, says, "For the just shall live by faith." And then over in Galatians chapter 2, it tells us again, "The just shall live by faith." And then in Hebrews 10:38, the writer says, "For the just shall live by faith." And then Paul wrote his letter to the Corinthian church, and I believe it's 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, he said this, "For we walk by faith, not by sight." Now the word "walk" is the same word that's translated "live" in the New Testament. He could have said, "For we live by faith, not by sight." Galatians chapter 3, verse 11, says in essence the same thing. "For the life that I live by the faith of God who loved me and gave himself for me." And then in the book of Hebrews, we have other exhortations that basically tell us the same thing. Live a life of faith and copy the example of those who have gone before you. And so faith is a lifestyle for the Christian. Faith determines your worldview. Faith determines how you view things. It should determine how you view things and how you respond to things. Faith should determine how you relate to other people. Faith should determine what you believe about yourself and your life. Now, I was with a brother, and Devin's not here this morning, but he and I were having a conversation about 10 days ago, 2 weeks ago, and I shared a scripture with Devin that would really, really make a difference in his life. And I said, here's what God's Word says. And I said, it will work for you if you believe it. If you believe it. I said, if you don't, it's still true. It's still powerful. It still works. But if you don't believe it, it's still there, and it'll lay there on the page and look at you. But it still works. But it won't work for you if you don't believe it. Now, we have a correlation with what happened to the children of Israel when they came out of Egyptian bondage. God had prepared for them the promised land, the land of Canaan. And they were encouraged, in fact, they were told to go take it. And the Lord said, I want you to go spy out the land, notice this expression, which I have given you. God always speaks in the past tense. In other words, I did it already. It belongs to you. Go get it. So 12 spies went into the land, agreed that it was a wonderful place, flowed with milk and honey, came back and told the broader congregation, yes, it's good, but there are walled cities, there are giants. We're like grasshoppers in their sight. They will nail us. We can't take it. Only 2 of the 10 came back with a good report, Joshua and Caleb, and they said, God said it's ours, let's go get it. But the majority believed the 10. Hey, you want a revelation this morning? Don't follow the herd. Because most of the time, the herd is wrong. You know that? When somebody says to you, hey, everybody's doing this, back up. Back up. In fact, Jesus said it like this, broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be that go in thereat. He said, but narrow is the way that leads to life, and few there be that find it. The herd is normally wrong. And so 10 of the 12 thought, can't do it. 2 said, God said, it's ours. Let's go get it. Yes. Now, listen, they saw the same giants. They saw the same walled cities. They saw the same things that the other 10 saw. But you know what was different about them? Faith. They believed what God said. The other 10 said, well, based on my estimation, we can't do this. And you know what? They got exactly what they said. So they wandered around in the wilderness for 40 years. And you might ask the question, why 40 years? Well, they spied out the land for 40 days. So because of their unbelief and disobedience, they had to wander in the wilderness a year for every day that their leaders spent checking out the promised land. And a whole generation had to die before they entered in. Now, it's interesting when you read the scripture, especially the Old Testament, and all of these accounts are laid out. Listen, these accounts are true. They're not just stories. Many times we have to be careful that we don't lump God's Word into the category of, you know, Mother Goose and all the other fairy tales that we teach our kids. All right? It's not a fairy tale. This is reality. This is real. And when they went into Jericho some 40 plus years later, they encountered a woman named Rahab who ran a brothel, okay? And she hid the two spies that came in to check out Jericho. And when the king realized that there were spies spying out his land, he started hunting for them. Came to Rahab, she said, well, there were some guys here earlier, but they took off a long time ago. And so she sent them on a wild goose chase. And then she sat down with these two men, and she said, listen to this. I know this land belongs to you, and you're going to take it. But I'm going to ask you one thing. When you do take this land, spare me and my family. Because I showed you this kindness to hide you. And they said, we will, if you meet certain conditions. Number one, you got to hang a cord from your home on the wall. Number two, everybody in your family has to be in your house. If they're not in the house, we can't guarantee their safety. And there's something that Rahab said, though, that I will never forget. She said, we've been afraid for 45 years. In other words, she said, what took you so long? We heard about what God did when you were delivered from Egypt and when you encountered kings on the other side. Our hearts melted within us. We had no defense. Now, she must have been a young girl when this happened. And she said, for 45 years, we've been waiting for you to show up. What took so long? Listen, there are many promises that God has entrusted to you. They belong to you. And you've let them sit for decades. Haven't used them. Haven't worked them. Well, I'm going to stir you up over the next 4 to 6 weeks so that you know, not only understand that you have faith, you're a person of faith, but you know how to use it. The problem with most Christian people is not that they don't have faith, they don't use it. And so what happens is they live their life living by their faculties, their resources. Are you with me? And wait until a crisis hits them like a brick wall. Now all of a sudden, the stuff that you've relied on all these years won't work. And now you're looking for God to intervene. Guess what? He'll meet you there. Amen. He'll meet you there. Amen. Now, the Bible tells us, turn with me if you will. I'm going to, instead of quoting this, Hebrews chapter 4. Let me show you something. Hebrews chapter 4. You know, I said the other day that as believers in Jesus Christ, we have a better covenant. Yes. And it is better only because the promises are better. Yes. So we have a better covenant based on better promises. Yes. Therefore, look at this. Hebrews 4, we'll start with verse 1. Therefore, since a promise remains of entering into his rest, referring to Christ, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have come short of it. For indeed, the gospel was preached to us as well as unto them, referring to the children of Israel. But the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. For those who have believed do enter into rest. And so here he's letting us know that the reason the children of Israel didn't enter into the promise, that generation, is they had the promise. They had the word. But they didn't mix faith with it. And so it did them no good. Well, that principle still applies today. We have promises. We have the word. But guess what? It won't do you any good if you don't mix faith with it. Amen? You know, my sister-in-law made me some chili the other day. Thank you again, Cheryl. Well, you know, there are a lot of different ways to make chili. But the important thing is you got to put the right ingredients in it. And so I dived into it. It was good. She put the right stuff in there. Amen? And so in order for us to live a successful Christian life, in order for us to successfully fight the good fight of faith, we have to do something. Yeah, we have the promise. We can talk about the promise all day long. But unless you mix faith with the promise, it'll lay there and look at you. And it won't work for you. Amen? And so this will change the way we approach things, the way we approach the Word of God. We're not just talking about your worldview and how you live your life, but listen, there are things that we can use that will not only impact us, but impact generations behind us. Our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren. You know, I saw a picture of my great-great-grandfather for the first time 2 years ago. I had never seen a photo of him. I didn't even know what his name was. But my sister found it and sent it to me. And of course, I knew who my great-grandfather was, but he passed on before I was born. I knew my great-grandmother, Mariah, and she was an old woman when I was a little boy. And I remember she was, you know, she'd spent a lot of years outdoors in the sun and had that real wrinkly skin. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah. Especially if you've been to the Southwest, and a lot of people who've worked outdoors and lived outdoors, your skin will react to the sun in funny ways. Well, my great-grandmother had real wrinkly skin and long white hair. And you know, when you're a little boy about 6-7 years old, that'll freak you out. It did me. And I remember she bent down one time, gave me a kiss on the cheek, and said, "Love you, Davy." And man, I was petrified. Great-grandma Mariah, you know? Well, what I didn't know was great-grandma Mariah was a Christian and served God. And you know, it's a cultural thing. A lot of black churches have church mothers. You know, what they do, they just pick the oldest woman in the church. She's the mother. Well, technically she's not, you know, so we don't necessarily embrace that tradition, you know, but the Bible does say the older women should teach the younger women. So there's a motherly role to be used by Christian women who have some experience. Now listen, if you've learned how to walk by faith for 30, 40 years, you need to share that with somebody younger than you, so they can learn to live by faith and come behind you and be strong. Now listen, faith can be quantified. Faith can be little. Faith can be great. Faith can be weak. Faith can be strong. Jesus said it on a couple of occasions. I haven't seen such great faith in all of Israel. You know? And then there were other times he said to his disciples, "Why are you afraid? And where is your faith?" Because it wasn't around. And so we're going to explore how to use your faith, number one, how to live by faith, number two, so you don't fall into the category of people who look at the promises all day long and they don't work for you because you're not mixing faith with it. Amen? Does everybody understand where we're going? Okay. Oh, it's wonderful. Now, we've seen all of these examples, and there again, if you want these scriptures again, you can write them down. These are the scriptures that refer to faith as a lifestyle. Habakkuk 2:4, Romans 1:17, Galatians 3:11, Hebrews 10:38, and 2 Corinthians 5:7. They all literally say the same thing, verbatim, the just shall live by faith. And so here we have five witnesses that literally say the same thing. I think God's trying to get our attention. Amen. Just like Mama used to tell me, you know, to do something. Here God has said it five times. The just shall live by faith. Now, turn with me. You're in Hebrews 4. Turn over to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. And, you know, we really, just a little sideline, we Bible theologians, we'll put it that way, don't know who wrote the book of Hebrews. But in the book of Hebrews, you see the revelation that was given to the Apostle Paul. All right, I'll give you a little theology lesson. It's called the Pauline revelation about the death, burial, resurrection of Christ and what it means to us. Paul was the first one to share about the local church. This is what Jesus' resurrection means. This is how you live it out. It's by faith, not by law. Okay? Now, for those who've, you know, it always works well, better, when you study. Instead of just taking what people say at face value and you know, hitching your wagon to it. You need to investigate carefully. But I heard this statement the other day. Oh, Christianity is what was given to you when you were slaves. It's the white man's religion. You ever hear that one before? I've heard it. But that's what happens when you don't study. You say stupid stuff like that. See, but if you read the Bible, especially the book of Acts. Now here the Apostle Paul has all this revelation about the local church, about the Holy Spirit and how he works. And you know who laid hands on the Apostle Paul before he started his first missionary journey? Three men laid hands on him. A guy named Simeon, who was black. A man named Lucius, who was from North Africa. And a man named Manaen, who grew up in Herod's household, wealthy family. These are the three men that put their hands on Paul the Apostle and said, go do what the Lord told you to do. Are you with me? See, two of the three were men of color, and one was definitely black. Laid hands on Paul the Apostle and imparted to him the graces necessary to preach the gospel with power and great witness. Amen. See, most people don't know that because they don't study.
Will you clap your hands right here? Come on.